Good morning, Oak Bridge. Will you stand and worship with us this morning?
They say this mountain can't be moved. They say these chains will never break. But they
You said, I believe. Awesome. You guys can take a seat for just a minute, but say hello to somebody around you before you do that, and then we'll sing it. You know, just to back up that song, Scripture says that we don't have a lot of things in our life simply because we don't go to our Heavenly Father, our good God, and ask Him. Or when we come to Him, Scripture says sometimes we ask with the wrong motives. So I want to give you guys just a moment on your own just to pray to God, to remember that we have a good Father that wants to give good things. And so just on your own, go to Him in prayer. Father in heaven, we just come to you and acknowledging that you are supreme, that you are the God of the universe, the King of the world, and you have no equal, no rival. And Father, somehow you love us, you care for us, you watch over us. We are the pinnacle of your creation, the apple of your eye. We come before you humbly, acknowledging again who you are, and we ask you, Father, to just accept our worship and our praise this morning. We thank you for your forgiveness and your love and the fact that you sent your son, Jesus Christ, to take care of our sin problems so that we could be reunited and reconnected with you. And all of that, we thank you and praise you in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. We're going to keep singing here in just a second. And you know, we've got a God, like I said, that loves us crazily, unconditionally. I think sometimes we think, and maybe on Sunday morning, maybe our week hasn't gone the way we've wanted, haven't acted like we've wanted to act, and we think sometimes that we have to get our act together, to clean ourselves up before we go to God, and that is simply not scriptural, not true. A God that loves us unconditionally and meets us where we are, but He doesn't want to keep us there. He loves us so much that He wants to change us and to become more like His Son, Jesus Christ. So I want us all to stand up. Let's sing praises to our King and to our God and be reminded of His love for us.
I've been strong and I've been broken within a moment. I've been wrathful and I've been reckless at every bend. I've held everything together and watched it shatter. I've stood tall and I have crumbled in the same breath. I have wrestled and I have trembled toward surrender. She's my heart adrift and drifted home again. Plundered blessings till I've been desperate to find redemption. And every time I turn around, Lord, you're still.
Don't deserve this kind of love. So somehow. This kind of love is who you are. It's a grace I could never add to be somebody you still want. But somehow you love me as you find. Who am I to think your glory needs my praises? If this borrowed breath is yours, Lord, take it all. You are faithful and you are gracious, and I'm just grateful. You don't need a single thing, still you own my. Before I was lost,
Awesome. You guys can go ahead and take a seat. You know, throughout the week, I speak to a whole lot of people. And normally when people come and see me, it's about problems, issues in their life, relationships, finances, health, all those kind of things. And honestly, when I'm speaking to people, most of the time I'm thinking in my head, how is this ever going to work out? This seems like an impossible situation. And, you know, for us, for humans, it oftentimes is. But as we just sang in that song, there is a God who is all powerful. There is nothing that is too difficult for him. And then also we've sang songs that remind us that God loves us, that he seeks us out, that his presence is always around. So I want us just to go to God in prayer before we hear from Tom this morning as we continue on in the Gospel of John. So let's pray. Father in heaven, as we've sang, you are all powerful. that prayer somehow in a mysterious way accesses your power. And I think, God, the key in this is that as we pray to you, we come to you and we learn who you are, and we communicate and we get to know one another. And Father, that alone is unfathomable, to think that we, these small little human beings, can actually interact and impact you, our King and the God of the universe. So Father, I pray for the person right now who seems like they're just in a spot that brings great fear and confusion and sickness and heartache, for the person that's just struggling with anxiety and depression, or just, again, God, just not knowing where to turn, what direction to head to. I pray, Father, that these people turn to you. You promise to sustain us. You promise to be our strength and our power as we surrender to you. So, Father, help us all to have humble hearts. Help us to acknowledge our total dependence upon you this morning, and help us to learn as Tom brings the Gospel of John to us. Father, bless his words, and again, help us to change, to be more like Jesus Christ, your Son. And it's in his name we pray. Amen.
Good morning. Good morning. Hey, let's give a round of applause to Oak Ridge Online. Welcome them. Hey, I'm going to talk about, let me just set it up for you, I guess. We're going to talk about the most popular verse that's ever been in the Bible. So if you're new to church, or if you said, you know what, I'm going to give it a whack today and see what happens, you get to hear the verse that is the most popular verse in all of Scripture. Now, this is kind of an important deal, because I'm going to tell you there's 31,000 verses make up the Bible. 31,000 verses. So if somebody says, hey, I want to memorize a verse, you could do that. If you say you want to memorize the Bible, you could do that. You just have to remember 31,000 verses. So out of 31,000 verses, we get a look at the singular, most popular verse in the entire Scripture out of these 31,000. It goes even a bit bigger than that. The Bible, by a massive count, is the most popular book ever written. The numbers just dwarf it. Every year it'd be the bestseller every year. There's still more Bibles sold every year than any other book it's not even close. So out of all the books ever sold, this one verse we read is the most popular verse, the most well-known verse out of every book ever written. That's how big this verse is. I can't blow it up enough to know. This is a huge verse. I don't know. There's 31,000 verses, and there's a lot of great ones in there, and there's a lot of ones that can change your mind, can change your heart, can change your life. But this one singular verse, I think it's right. I think if you know this verse, if you understand this verse, if you can tell people about this verse, I think there's so much weight and so much power in this verse that I think you won't be able to walk out of here not thinking more about this verse than you thought about it before. And if you've never heard it, then this one verse, I think, almost encapsulates all the other 31,000 verses. So I'm not telling you not to read the Bible, but I'm telling you, if you're going to read the Bible, this is one verse you better know, you better understand, you better pour into, and you better understand why it's so popular. All right. So with that said, I want to give you some background before we jump into the verse. There's some things you need to know to understand this one singular verse. We're just not going to read one from John, but to understand this, there's a couple things you need to know. You need to know one story that I'm going to tell you here, and then you need to know one person. If you know this one story and this one person, then this verse, when it comes, you'll come and you'll go, okay, I feel it more now. I understand it more. I appreciate it more now. I get it more now. That's this one verse. So if you're with a person that's next to you and they're kind of dozing off, I understand it, but just give them a sharp elbow to the ribs and we'll be ready to go on this one. I really want you to hear this. And if you're watching online, God's Spirit can touch you every bit as much online as he can in this room. So I'd encourage you to perk up a little bit, take another sip of coffee, and see if God has something that he wants you to know about this one verse that he inspired, this powerful verse. Here's the story. Here's the first thing, story. And I named the story this: replace complaining with gratitude and you will see less snakes. That's the name of the story I'm going to tell you. Replace complaining with gratitude and you'll see less snakes. You have to know this story to understand this verse we're going to talk about. My mom never liked complaining. She didn't like complainers at all, at least people that complained to her or with her. All right, she would complain now and then, but my wife never really liked it if you complained. And she really wasn't much of a complainer or an excuse maker. My mom had a time period in her life where within a six-month period, she'd carried a baby full term. They kind of knocked her out at birth. There's phone. I think that's my phone. Could you turn that off? Yeah, turn that thing off, will you? I knew that was going to happen someday. I don't know how to turn the phone off. I got a new phone. I don't know how to turn it on or off.
You have a very intelligent pastor.
Okay, where was I at? All right. My mom, within a six-month period, carried a baby full term, and then it was a tough pregnancy, and then they kind of knocked her out at that time period. This would have been over 55 years ago, and she wakes up basically 2 days later, and she realized that her baby had died, that it was born with birth defects, and the baby didn't make, even though they didn't know anything about that during the birth time period. And then a short time period after that, a couple months after that, my mom and dad moved to their home that I grew up in Indianapolis, and there was a fire as they're moving into the house. And it happened to be my brother, myself and my brother Steve, older brother Steve, were in the garage, and I got third-degree burns all over my legs, and we're in the hospital for the next 3.5 months. And my brother Steve got second-degree burns. And so during this time period, you know, she had a lot of pressure put on her. My older brother Steve, whom I love dearly, I have great respect for, was born with one arm. And great athlete. If you guys know my brother Steve, he's a great athlete. And my grandma told my mom, who, I mean, it's too much information, but my mom's not here, so I'll tell you it anyway, and we just got to keep it between us. Steve was conceived out of wedlock, and my grandma, my dad's mom, told my mom when Steve was born, see, that's what you get for having a baby conceived out of wedlock. So you can understand, my mom didn't like complainers. She didn't like excuse makers. My mom didn't like, she wasn't that kind of person that would throw that on people. She said, okay, this is how things are. This is how they play out. Let's go for it. And she really wasn't an excuse maker at all. And she'd tell us all the time, I remember growing up, just quit your whining. And then she'd say something I can't repeat here in front of you, but she'd say, you'd complain if somebody blanked on your plate. I never understood this. Because, yes, I would complain if somebody did that. Yes. And I still don't understand it. At age 64, I still don't understand it. But she didn't like complaining, and she didn't like whiners. And I thought about that a lot. And I don't think you do either. I mean, I don't think any of you guys have grown up saying, well, I hope my children become complainers. You know, I hope they become whiners. No one says to your kids, I tell you what, sweetheart, why don't you complain about the food? All right, I know it wasn't my, your clothes. I know you need new Lululemon. I realize they're only $700, but I understand you need that. Our house, why don't you complain about our house a little bit more? Or the dog, or your brother, or the shower, or our car, or our vacation, or our country, or our city, or your school. Why don't you complain more? I don't think you've ever taught your kids this. God loves a cheerful complainer. I just don't think that's it. So a question, even before I get into this message, which is not part of it, maybe just God has this for you. I've learned to say that there's no throwaway parts of a message, because God can use a poorly written message or a well-written message. But so for today, we're going to talk about the most powerful verse, but before I get there, how's your complaint meter today? Just wanted to ask you. I mean, this is not part of the message. This is totally separate. How is it? Is your complaint meter bigger than your gratitude meter? I mean, is your complaint tank more full than your gratitude tank? Which is it? I think we all agree we don't like complainers. And I'm going to tell you something else that's maybe a surprise to you, neither does God. He really doesn't. I think the opposite of gratitude is complaining or whining. And I think God wants gratitude. And I think there's power in gratitude. And I think you all deserve it. And somehow in this world, it is easy to complain. It is easy to whine. And it's hard to be grateful. But grateful is much better. So just the question one more time. Maybe today's God's got you. And he says, hey, look, I love you, but I'm talking to you now. Are you a complainer? Do you really want to be a complainer? And do you really want to have a bunch of complainers around you? All right. So here's the story. It's found in Numbers 21, 4 through 9. Roughly written 3,500 years ago. This is when it went on. And the Israelite people had just been delivered out of bondage, out of slavery. They were slaves in Egypt for a long time. We referenced the Pharaoh's story, I think it was last week, about how the people left. And they'd been wandering now, waiting to go to the promised land. They'd been wandering through this desert area, through this region, just going, not knowing where they're even going. They weren't sure where they're supposed to go. But this went on for 40 years. And there's reasons why God had this generation wander for 40 years before they got to the promised land. But one of them was there were a large group of complainers. That was, I mean, you think, is it a big deal? I think it's a big deal. And when you read this, I think you're going to understand. This helps us understand John, where we're going. All right, here's Numbers 21, 4 through 9. They traveled, this is the Israelites, from Mount Hor along the route to the Red Sea to go around Edom. But the people grew impatient on the way, and they spoke against God and against Moses. And they said, why have you brought us up out of Egypt to die in the wilderness? There is no bread, there is no water, and we detest this miserable food. Now, pop for a second. There were slaves in Egypt. That's where they're at. And God pulls them out of there. And he even creates water out of a rock. And he provides honey. And there's another thing he provided here. It was called manna. Now, read this again. There is no bread here. There is no water. And we detest this miserable food. Who made the food? God. Have you ever made a meal and somebody goes, "This tastes, our dog shouldn't eat this." And you go, oh, no, that makes me feel great. Now, I don't know what manna was like. And by the way, I understand the people a little bit. There's some meals I love. But you serve it to me 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 days in a row. And I'm like, no, I don't like that pizza. Emo's pizza is good one day. Maybe leftovers. Third day, no, I don't want any more Emo's pizza. So they're saying miserable food. They're complaining, they're whining. God had miraculously done these 10 things for them, these 10 supernatural miracles, and now they're out and they're whining. Now, I don't know how long it took. I don't know how long along the journey in 40 years this was in, but they were whining. Then the Lord, listen to this. So God's response, I mean, I wrote this and I thought, okay, they're complaining. Now what's God's response? I love it. Then the Lord sent venomous snakes among them. They bit the people and many Israelites died. That don't sound very godlike, does it? We serve a big God, a God of justice, a God of mercy, and a God of love. Well, we serve a God we need to respect. And to a great degree, even fear, because he is that powerful. And yet, when we understand this part, we're going to hold this up against what John teaches us, which I think is the biggest part of God. The people came to Moses and they said, we sinned and we spoke against the Lord and against you. Pray that the Lord will take the snakes away from us. So Moses prayed for the people. Verse 8, pretty key part. The Lord said to Moses, make a snake and put it up on a pole. Anyone who is bitten can look at it and live. So Moses made a bronze snake. He put it up on a pole. Then when anyone was bitten by a snake and looked at the bronze snake, they lived. They said, hey, Lord, take these snakes away from us. We have people getting bites and they're dying. And God could have just, as easily as he brought the snakes, I think he could have sent them away. But he didn't do that. He made something. And he said, I want you to look at it. And when you look at it, it will remove the snake bite. It will fix whatever is bitten by you, and you'll be okay. In other words, you're going to have to look at this, and you're going to trust me. You're going to have some faith. I'm not going to take away all the things that are part of this broken world, and venomous snakes are part of it. You're going to have some faith. That's what he says. I'm guessing there's some people that are bit by snakes. I will not look at that. I will not look at that. And I'm guessing they died. And God gave that right. But he gave them a way to overcome snake bites through faith in what he did. That's story number one. You got to remember, Jesus is going to refer to this story, which was written 1,500 years before he walked the earth. Here's the second thing. I told you about a person. How many of you guys are rule followers? Raise your hand if you're a rule follower in here. I knew it because I said raise your hand. I knew you would. All right? You were a rule follower. Get him up again where you can see. Get him up. You're a rules follower. And I'm going to define it for you a little bit here. All right? You follow precise directions when you're cooking. I mean, if they say a teaspoon of salt, you just don't take your finger in there and throw a little bit in there. As if that's you, I mean, you think about these are rule followers, all right? You don't make right turns on red. Even if it's legal, you won't make a right turn on red. There's some people that, nah, it's red. It's legal, you can take a right turn, there's no sign. No, I'm not gonna turn. Or how about this one? You won't tear those big tags off your pillows. I mean, I go to some of your houses and you have this tag sitting there and I'm like, there's nobody going to come and get you when you rip this thing off. I'm not a rules follower, which at times gets me in trouble. And I go to your house and you won't even be looking. I'll rip that tag off. That tag is going. It is gone. I'll go into some of the stores. I think that's why Bed Bath & Beyond went out of business. I tore a lot of their tags off their pillows. No, it's not going to happen. I didn't, but I should have. How many of you can't take something out of the microwave early? If you set it for 30 seconds, you're a rule follower, it bugs you. You can't. All right, these rule followers, so there's people that are just like that. They just have to follow the rules. We have people at our church that are like that. Tracy Hagen, I love her to death. She's our accountant, and she's a rule follower. And she will want a receipt, or she'll want why we did this. And I go, like, it's okay. I'm not ripping us off. We're okay on this one, right? No, this is Tom. We need this. Here's what we have. I said, we're not going to get audited by the IRS. We're just a little church. Tom, here's what we have. She's a rules follower. And I love it. And I love it in certain people. But that's how this person, today we're going to talk about, they're a rule follower. And it's a guy. And he helped make up rules to follow. That's how much of a rule. He was very spiritual. He was very influential. He was very educated. And he was very wealthy. He was also a term called, he was a Pharisee. And a Pharisee is simply a member of a Jewish sect that followed the Jewish laws closely. So he was a member of this specific part of the Jewish faith called a Pharisee. And he followed all the laws. Diet laws, dietary laws, who he associated with, clothing that they're supposed to wear, holy days that they're supposed to observe. I mean, if it was written anywhere in Scripture or taught by some influential rabbi, he was a rules follower. That's what they did. And he's also a member of the Sanhedrin. Now, this is really interesting. The Pharisees were kind of an exclusive group. I mean, you had to want to follow certain things and do certain ways, but he's a member of the Sanhedrin. And the Sanhedrin was the ruling court, the religious court of all Israel. So imagine the Supreme Court of Israel. They were the ones that they settled the most important cases in the land. So this guy was not just a Pharisee. He was not just wealthy and educated and influential and spiritual. He was also a member of the Sanhedrin, a select group of people that ruled over all the Jewish people religiously. And his name was Nicodemus. That was his name. That's who this guy is. So if you think of Nicodemus from around, just think rule follower, religious, and spiritual. Now we jump into the book of John. You've heard a story about bronze snake lifted up on a pole. You've heard about Nicodemus. You should fully be able to understand what we're going to learn now in John. John 3, 1 through 2. Now there was a Pharisee, a man named Nicodemus, who was a member of the Jewish ruling council. The Jewish ruling council's name was Sanhedrin. That's what we just said. He came to Jesus at night and said, Rabbi, we know that you're a teacher who has come from God, for no one could perform the signs you're doing if God were not with him. Now I pause as I read this, and I realize that one of the most powerful men in all Israel was a guy named Nicodemus. I know that because he was a Pharisee. I know that because he's a member of the Sanhedrin, the Supreme Court of Israel. And he comes to Jesus. Now we read in there, and the writer tells us, John tells us, he came at what? What time? What time of day? Day or night? Night. Now we don't really know why. There's nothing specified, but I think we could read into this. If you go to somebody's house at night and it's specified, you're sneaking in. You don't want people to see you. I think that's what's going on here. Here's this guy named Nicodemus, and there's this guy named Jesus, who a lot of Nicodemus' buddies are saying, this Jesus, he's bad news. He sneaks in at night. And then he comes in, and he does this, which is amazing. Here's a higher-up guy, and he calls Jesus Rabbi, which is a sign of respect. It means teacher. Rabbi, a Supreme Court guy, rabbi, a teacher of the law that God had given. A teacher of the law calls him rabbi, teacher. So we realize Nicodemus knows something about Jesus. There's something curious about Jesus. And he didn't have to be respectful, but he was. Rabbi, we know that your teacher has come from God. For no one could perform the signs you're doing. God, we're not we're not with him. So we know that Nicodemus was spiritual. He had a thing for God. I was spiritual. There was a time I was spiritual. I'm going to get back to a specific time I'll tell you about. But I knew that there was a God. I've never questioned whether somebody created this. I can't get my mind around that this is just all random chance. Or there's a big bang. I go back to who created the bang then? Somebody started this. Now, I can't get back. My mind just is hard to get around the idea that somebody, something existed forever. My mind is finite. That's the start and end. But I come back to the point that there's just a God. There is a God. And he's amazing. Because you can't look at creation and not be stunned. You can't look at birth, a human, an animal, and think where it started and how it becomes formed and not think amazing things. I knew there was a God. And by the way, I also kept most of the commands. Growing up as a kid, I had a rebellious streak, only to the point that I didn't like to follow rules. But the rules I broke were normally minor rules. Kathy and I broke a few big ones. But they're normally only minor rules. That was the reality of it. And I thought my behavior, honestly, would please God. I did believe that. And compared to some other people that I knew, specifically in high school, my good meter was a lot higher than their good meter, the human good meter. I mean, I knew they did some tough things, and I just didn't do those things, and I didn't participate in those things. So I was spiritual, just like Nicodemus. I thought about a God, wanted to know this God more, and I had tried to do good things and follow rules and follow laws. I was spiritual. I wonder if Nicodemus said all this to Jesus. I wonder if after we just read where it said, for no one could perform these signs you're doing if God were not with him. I wonder if Nicodemus said, well, see, you know, I'm spiritual too. I mean, I want to know, I love God, and here's the stuff I do. I'm not like all those people that don't follow the rules, that don't try and please God, that don't do that. I mean, I'm spiritual. Can't you see, Jesus, what I've done? I'm on the Sanhedrin. I'm a Pharisee. I mean, I'm influential. I think he did. I think he told Jesus all that. I really do. John 3, 3 through 9. Here's how Jesus responded. Jesus replied, "Very truly I tell you, no one can see the kingdom of God unless they're born again." He tells them about how good he is, about the things he's done, the rules he's followed. And instead, Jesus could have said, great, hey, way to go. You're the kind of guy that I want to mold. You're the kind of guy that's on my team. Instead, he says, Jesus replied, very truly I tell you, no one can see the kingdom of God unless they're born again. You can't even see what it's like to live for God and by God unless you've been born again. That's the term he says. You don't even know what it looks like. And Nicodemus is saying, what do you mean I don't know what it looks like? I'm the rule maker. I've written some of the rules. I follow the rules. I'm on the Sanhedrin. I make the biggest court decisions there are. Jesus says, unless you've been born again, you can't even see the kingdom of God. Well, Nicodemus asks something that, from our vantage point, it seems stupid. He says, how can someone be born when they're old? Nicodemus asks. Surely they cannot enter a second time into their mother's womb to be born. He says, you're going to be born again. He says, so what do I do, jump back in my mom's womb? Is that what you're talking about? And Jesus answered, very truly I tell you, no one can enter the kingdom of God. Before he said, you can't even see the kingdom of God. Now he's saying, no one can even enter the kingdom of God unless they're born of water and spirit. He said, born of water, you're pregnant, ladies. Go with me. You're pregnant. How do you know the baby's coming? Your water what? Breaks. Jesus is referring to this right here. Unless you're born of water and of the Holy Spirit, you can't even enter the kingdom of God. This is what born again is. Now, I got to believe right now, Nicodemus is thinking some major questions. Who is this guy? I've seen him do some major miracles. I know he's from God. Jesus saying, very truly, I tell you, no one can enter the kingdom of God unless they're born of water and spirit. Flesh gives birth to flesh, but the spirit gives birth to spirit. You should not be surprised at my saying, you must be born again. The wind blows wherever it pleases. You hear its sound, but you cannot tell where it comes from, where it is going. So it is with everyone born of the Spirit. He says, how can this be? And he said, you can't force the Spirit to come. You need to be born of it. And he said, how can it be? He says, how can I do this? How can we be born again, is what he ends this question with. And right now, I got to give Nicodemus some credit. He's got a great story. He's a Pharisee on the ruling council. He's a spiritual person. And yet he asks, after he's told something plainly that he doesn't understand or might even go against his way of living, I got to give him credit. He asked a question of Jesus. Now I want to stop for some of you. See, some people when you speak to, and you start to talk about Jesus, and they're spiritual, they'll stop you right there in your tracks. And they'll go, I don't care what you believe or what you know or what you say. I don't want to hear about it. Listen, some of you are married to that person. They say they're spiritual, meaning what they're saying is, hey, I'm a pretty good person. Hey, I've got a pedigree, a story. At least I'm better than that person. And in fact, that person probably is pretty good by worldly standards, human standards. That's just not our benchmark. So he says, how can this be? And I give Nicodemus credit because he at least asked a question. He didn't walk out. He could have turned right around and said, it sounds like you're offending me. I'm going to walk away. Now I love this part. He said, how can this be? Nicodemus asked, I love this. Here's what Jesus said in John 3:10-15. He said, you are Israel's teacher, said Jesus, and you do not understand these things? Very truly I tell you, we speak of what we know. Now he's talking about what God knows. We speak of what we know and we testify to what we have seen. But still you people do not accept our testimony. The apostles and the disciples have been talking about what Jesus had done. He said, I've spoken to you of earthly things and you do not believe. How then will you believe if I speak of heavenly things? How will you believe if I speak of heavenly things? Then he makes a statement that's curious, except I want to break it down. He says, no one has ever gone into heaven except the one who came from heaven, the Son of Man. Jesus used this term, Son of Man, in the Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, over 70 times. It was the main thing that he called himself, Son of Man, meaning God came down as a man. He's Son of Man. That's how he referred to himself. Stephen, when he was getting stoned to death, for you Christians that know this story, he looked up in heaven, he's getting stoned to death, and he said, I see the Son of Man, talking about Jesus, sitting at the right hand of God. That's what he saw. And so Jesus comes as the Son of Man. He said, no one has gone to heaven except one who came from heaven, the Son of Man. Go back to the verse. No one has gone into heaven except the one who came from heaven. See, that to me, faith is always an ascend-descend thing. Let me go back to this. If you're spiritual, people that call themselves spiritual, they believe in ascension, that they can bring themselves up to God, that their behavior can be good enough to bubble against God, that they're better than other people, so therefore God wouldn't judge them or his wrath wouldn't go in there, so they're trying to ascend up to God. That's religion, that your works are enough for God. And that's fine if the comparison was us, but if it's God, we're nowhere close to God in his holiness. And so the descension part of this is Jesus says no one comes up but except one came down. In other words, now Christianity teaches that God came what? Down. It's not that we work our way up. It's that God came his way down. That's what Christianity is. So we read this. No one has ever gone into heaven except the one who came from heaven. So you can't work your way up. God came down. He's talking about himself, the Son of Man. Then he makes this statement. Just as Moses lifted up the snake in the wilderness, so the Son of Man must be lifted up, that everyone who believes may have eternal life in him. Now stop. You remember the snake? The bronze snake that was lifted up? That when they looked at it and they were bit, when they looked at it and they had done something wrong, when they looked at it and they were judged by God, when you looked at the snake and in faith you trusted what God did and you were healed? You see what Jesus is reflecting here? He says, just, you want to know how to be born again. Just as Moses lifted up the snake in the wilderness, so the Son of Man himself, I must be lifted up, that everyone who believes in me may have eternal life. That you look at me through faith, not your works. You're not ascending. I descended. That's what he's trying to teach here. That's why he came to teach us. Many of you are lovely people. And compared to me, you're probably far better than I am as a human. But all of us, every one of us, fall so short of God that it's not even a measurement. And every one of us deserve the wrath of God. Because we've all hurt people, we've all not loved, we've all not done things, or we've done things we shouldn't do. Every one of us. So he says, it's not about all your rules, Nicodemus. It's not about all your do's and your don'ts. It's not about, before I say this, sin has consequences. You know that. We know that. But it's not about whether you sin less or sin more. You sin. It's not about you ascending up to God as if you could. It's about what I've done for you and your faith and your belief. It's about your faith in God, your trust in God, your belief in God for what he's done for you. And he's trying to make this reference. Nicodemus, someday you will see me on the cross. I don't want to jump ahead too far in John. Sometime we'll get there in 2025. But I will tell you this. That John asked, that Nicodemus asked for Jesus' body after he was crucified. He asked for his body publicly. Something changed in the next 6 chapters. I hope the same change goes on in you, and I hope it goes on in me. That's the journey we're on. So get this. So he says, the Son of Man must be lifted up, and everyone who believes may have eternal life in him. If I'm Nicodemus, I say, why? Why if it's not work? Why if it's looking at this thing that's been lifted up on a pole? Why? But why? That's what I would be asking. Why? And here's how he was answered. John 3:16-17. Why? Why? For God so loved the world. That's you, Nicodemus. That he gave his one and only son. That's me. That whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life. For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but to save the world through him. It's not about a religion of ascending. It's about a faith of believing in the descending God that came, that loved us so much, that he put his Son, came the Son of Man, on a cross. And if we believe in him, though we will die, we shall not die. Our death is death unto life. That's the statement we read. That God is for us, and Jesus is the proof. For everyone, everywhere, male, female, white, black, young, old, terrible sinner, light sinner. For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish but have eternal life. For God did not send Jesus in the world to condemn us, but to save us. I think there were people in the desert that didn't look at that snake raised on the pole. I think they died. I don't want any of you to die. I want the best day of your life to be before you, when you celebrate with people that have gone before you, because they've trusted with faith in this Jesus. I want some of you, like my mom, to see her daughter, who she never really held on this earth, to rejoice with her because sin has been beaten and that baby is whole and her name's Jody. I want that celebration. That's what God wants, for God so loves you, not because of what you've done, but because of who you are. You're his treasured son or daughter. That is the power of this verse, to understand that our faith is the victory in Christ. And that's why this verse, people have got to understand. You have to understand that God loves you, and what he did for you is for all people, at all times, everywhere. Religion is spelled D-O. You've probably heard this. Religion is spelled do. Christianity is spelled D-O-N-E. Spelled done. It was done by Jesus. He's our faith. So back to my story. I was spiritual. I thought the works plan was a fairly good plan. I could always find somebody that was worse than me. Then the light bulb started to click up. Started to get a little warmer, a little brighter. And I started to realize my benchmark. I wasn't going to stand before Joe or Brenda or Karen or Mike. I was going to stand before the Holy God. And the more I came to know this God by knowing Jesus, the more I realized I needed more of Jesus. Not more of myself. I needed more of Jesus. Then at age 21, through faith, I asked Jesus to be my Savior. Through faith, I was baptized into the life, the death, and the resurrection of Jesus. Through faith, I started to trust God more with everything in my life. Through faith, I tried to share my faith with other people. And it's not that I'm better than other people, because I know I'm not. But I know the one who is. And his name's Jesus. And I was born again. And someday, though I die, though this body expires from this earth, my spirit will not die. And it will be with Christ. So that's the question I want to ask you today. Are you born again? Have you put your faith in Jesus? Have you understood that God loves you and he's for you? You can do that. I mean, mine was simply through a prayer, a confession of faith. I said, God, I believe that Jesus is your son. I believe that he's my Savior. I want him to be the Lord of my life, the director of my life. And when I fall down, I want to get back up and look right back towards you again, God. And I want you to guide me. And I want that for my children. And I want that for my grandchildren. And eventually I can make the statement, I want that for our church that we're part of. So I want to give you a moment. Just to go to God. And maybe there's something that's clicked on inside of you, and maybe you realize a little bit more today that that verse, John 3:16, is not just a verse the whole world should know, but it's a verse that God wrote so you would know it. So I'm going to ask you to just say this together with me. Instead of the world, I want to ask you to say your name. So follow along with me, right? For God so loved Tom that he gave his one and only son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish. For God did not send his son into the world to condemn Tom, but to save Tom through him. And I want you to just go to God with the prayer and say that silently. And some of you, for the first time, accept Christ. Be born again. Father, we just thank you for being here. I thank you for some of our eyes that were open today. I thank you for these words which have changed so many lives, so many eternal zip codes. God, I thank you for that. I pray that for these next few moments when we sing, that it'd be more than just words on a page. It'd be more than just notes, that it actually is the reflection of our hearts towards you, God. God, we praise you. And we thank you that we live in the church age, the age of truth and grace, as we see in Jesus Christ. God, may these words be pleasing to your ear, and may you touch our hearts as we do. God, we praise you and we thank you. It is in Jesus' name we pray. And all God's people said, amen. Let's stand and sing.
within your presence. I speak Jesus.
Today was a spiritual day for you. I hope it was a holy day, but more than anything, I hope you understand John 3:16 more than you ever have before. And for some of you, I hope you went from being just a spiritual person to a born-again person. For some of you, I hope you moved from religion into a relationship with God through Jesus Christ. And I think there's people up in heaven that are writing down saying, yeah, well, Cindy did and Mike did and Kevin and Joe, and I think all heaven rejoices for those that have done that. Hey, as a public witness that you trust Jesus, that you love Jesus, there's this ordinance that's been given called baptism, where you identify with the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ by going into the water. Next Sunday, January 21st at 4 p.m., we have a baptism service, and we have
16 people signed up.
16 people signed up. On the day of Pentecost, when all people realized they could be born again by trusting in Christ, 3,000 people were baptized. There's room for you. There's room for you. It's a witness to your family and your friends. It's time for some of you to take that step as a believer. As a born-again follower of Jesus, take that step. You can sign up online. You can sign up in the Connect Room. Herc will call you during the week and we'll talk about what it looks like. But it's Sunday, big celebration. We're going to eat a lot of cake next week. What?
It's heated.
Yes, it's heated. The jacuzzis are warm. So that said, we got a couple announcements. First of all, if you're new to our church, we'd love you to go to the Information Center and give you one of these cards. Tells you everything about our church, all the things that are going on, and we'll give you a, if you bring this coupon that's in here and bring it to the Connect Room, they'll give you a free t-shirt for you and everybody that's with you. And Herc, you've got a couple other announcements.
Yeah, we've got Grief Share starting up in a couple weeks. You can sign up online. Check your bulletin for this stuff. The Edge tonight is the first one back. We're planning on having that unless something with weather changes this evening. And then starting, not this Wednesday, but next Wednesday, I've got a toolbox class starting up called Understanding the Bible. Maybe you made a New Year's resolution to read through the Bible in a year, and now you're getting close to Leviticus or something like that, and you're thinking, what the heck? I'll tell you, go through this class, and you're going to be able to understand the Bible and have more confidence in a way that maybe you thought not possible. You'll get a free Bible at the end of the 3 weeks. You can sign up for that online, and then after that, there's class on the Holy Spirit. So a lot of things starting up.
We've also got the Reflection Room behind us. I would encourage all of you, if you can, to go take communion and remember exactly what God has done for us. Last thing I wanted to say, on the count of three, I want you to say the name of Jesus as loud as you can on the count of three. Ready? One, two, three. Jesus. Yes. See you guys next week. Thanks for coming.